Jesus commands all the hosts of heaven. Who else can make every king bow down? Who else can whisper and darkness trembles? Only a holy God. What of the beauty demands such praises? What of the splendor outshines the sun? What of the majesty rules with justice? Only a
You're a scoundrel, and I'm...
he's standing out there. I can see him. He turned his mic on.
Good morning and welcome to Madison Church of Christ. I'm so glad you joined us for worship this morning. Today at Madison, we have all kinds of stuff going on. This afternoon, we're in charge of Brookhaven service at 1:30. This evening, we're going to have a block party. Now, this year, there's been a little confusion. Somebody asking me if they don't live on our block, can they come to our block party? The answer is yes, because the Bible says that we are neighbors. Remember the question asked to Jesus, who is my neighbor? Anyway, you get the point. So you're our neighbors, and you're invited to our block party. We're going to be grilling hamburgers and hot dogs. So that'll be provided. If you want to bring a side dish or a dessert, you can. And that'll be a great time. This week, on Tuesday evening at 7 o'clock, we're going to have a Sunday school meeting. And so we're just going to talk about Sunday school at Madison, and some curriculum and stuff like that. And so if you are interested in helping with Sunday school or you're already helping with Sunday school, we'd love for you to attend that meeting Tuesday night at 7 o'clock. You may have noticed that there are bins and signs out there for Operation Christmas Child in the lobby. So we're getting ready to pack shoeboxes again this year. And so if you have things for us to put in there, you can leave them in the bin. And we're getting ready for Operation Christmas Child. For Madison Kids, on December 1st, there is a play, a Narnia play, that we are going to take a group to. And so the tickets for that play are $10, and we'll take a group on December 1st. But we need to know by today if you want to go. So if you want to take some kids to see Narnia, talk to Brianna and today, and we'll go. It'll be a good time. And then finally, you may have noticed also in the lobby some big, giant pictures with floor plans. The Madison Building Committee has been meeting since before I got here, many times for many hours, and we've just really spent a lot of time and care working on a plan to build on at Madison. And so you guys have been with us through this process over the last year. I think it was at last year's annual meeting where we really discussed this. And we are at the end of that long process. And so we're finally about to begin this addition. And we have a floor plan out there in the foyer that you can look at. And there'll be some people from the building committee out there if you have any questions about what you see there and about the addition after the service. Our purpose in doing this is we wanted to make Madison a place where all generations can worship. And so we know that the stairs to go downstairs and to use the restrooms present a barrier to that. And so in our addition, we're hoping to resolve that. So we are resolving the problem of access for the elderly who struggle with stairs, and we're going to add some facilities for families with young children so that we can be able to accommodate them better. And since last time we talked about the addition, one of the things we've added is an elevator, a lift elevator onto the plan. And we had thought about adding a whole fellowship hall and kitchen to the main floor upstairs, but we weren't able to do that in our addition, so we wanted to make sure that we could put an elevator in this addition so that if someone's unable to use the stairs, they can have access to the fellowship hall, and we can worship and do events together at Madison. So now is the time to fulfill the pledges that we've made to the building project. And so we are starting to collect the money that we've pledged for the building plan, because things are going to start moving here in the next few weeks. You may see a hole open up in the ground over here on the south side of the church. And so the time has arrived. And I just ask for your continued support and prayer for our building project. And if you have any questions about that, you can talk to me, and I'll at least direct you to the right person. As we enter into worship today, I'd like you to stand with me as we read a verse from 1 Chronicles. These are the words of David, and if you're following along in our building plan, they're words that we read this week. When David was bringing the ark into Jerusalem, he said this: "Ascribe to the Lord, all you families of nations. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness."
Praise belong to you. You now.
We have a privilege to be able to come to the Father this morning with our concerns and our praises. I've got a couple of them here I want to bring up to everyone at the congregation. This morning we learned that last night or yesterday afternoon, what time? Mike Brown, he's a guy out at the lake. He was mowing some grass, and with his tractor and mower went over a retaining wall, down through the hill and into another wall, and he came out in pretty bad shape. He's got a part of a broken neck, I think it was his wrist or his arm, and a femur, and he's going through surgery in about another hour and 15 minutes. So I want to be in prayer for him. He is a former son-in-law of Dorothy and John Banzoff, just in case anybody cares. The relationship part. And then Amy Townsend's uncle, Philip Squires. He's been having some health issues. She said we can mention this. He has been in ICU, but I guess he's doing better. Is this correct?
Heart's better, infection's worse.
Okay, well, we still need to lift him up in prayer then. Okay. And
Jim and Laurel, last Sunday I went to visit, and they were not in the same room, so they're not in the same room. In case, so, at any rate, let's go to the Lord in prayer. We all have our own concerns, of course, and I've been kind of trying to use the word push in my day as an anagram about pray until something happens, not giving up. And so it's just one of those things we need to keep, especially in these times, folks. And there's a lot of things happening, and the world is seeing a lot of turmoil. And unless the body itself is strengthened with each other, we can find ourselves falling pretty easily. So we thank God for the congregation. We thank God for the body of Christ. I thank you for each one of you. To give that strength to each other. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning with thanksgiving on our hearts for who you are. We thank you for your love for each one of us and the plan that was given through Jesus that each one of us have the opportunity to choose to be on your side, to be able to have an eternal life with you. Father, this morning as we continue our worship, and during the sermon time that Joel brings, we ask your Spirit to be upon us, to give us strength. And as we think of our loved ones and friends and acquaintances who have all been through struggles, we ask your Spirit to be upon them, to give them strength, whether it be in healing or spirit. We just praise your name, Father. It's all in Jesus' name that we lift up in prayer. Amen.
You continue singing with us.
Hallelujah, God, your glory. Hallelujah, God, your glory. Good morning to everyone. Faith, hope, love. And the greatest of these is love. Those words were spoken 1 Corinthians 13:13. We were taught last week in Joel's sermon how Jeremiah was given all of these and much, much more. He was given them before he was even born. We are like Jeremiah in every way, shape, and form. We were also given these before we were born. But along our path of life that we lead each and every day here on earth, our faith, hope, and love sometimes wanes and definitely gets tested each and every day by the life of others or by conditions outside of our control. We are certainly assured by the words of God through the Bible that our God will always, always be there. We are assured this constantly, whether it be in times of distress, sadness, sickness, brokenness, anguish, or sorrow. We can always count on our God to do what is best for us. We certainly enjoy the good times, and all of these will come along in our life at some point in time. In the last month, the people of Marshalltown and Pella, just to name a couple cities, have been tested by their faith, their hope, and their love. And that was given to them as well. We are not alone. Our community and nation has been tested in the last month and a little over right now by the disappearance of Molly. These two happenings, as well as many others in our lives, makes us wonder what God's plan is for each one of us and others. Even though these three are very, very strong in our daily lives, we still struggle with God's plan. Being Christians, we know we are assured by the words of our Bible. But how can we be reassured each day besides reading the Bible and doing what it says? I believe we can be reassured by just one word. And that word I've chosen is people. People like all of you here, people outside of these walls. When the tornadoes hit, people were there with their support, just by showing up to show their love, hope, and faith in them to restore everything that was torn apart, whether it be their buildings or their personal life. Everyone helped in one shape or another. A couple weeks ago, Kathy and I went into Chicago for a short vacation, and we took flyers and pens and all that to distribute, and we were somewhat amazed by how many people had already put out things. What amazed me was the people, and when I say that, I mean many people. We had our shirts on, so they know we knew something about the situation. And we come away when we left of how kind the people were. They did not want to know any of the gory details. They didn't want to know this or that. One of the first things, this one gentleman come up, he shook my hand and says, "We're praying for you." And that meant a lot. It meant a lot. We're never in any situation alone, never. Whether it be sorrow, even the good times, we are not alone. And I guess that's what was amazing to me, that they didn't want to know any of the details. One person said, "We follow this every morning on the news. And they just wanted to know, we're thinking of you when we're praying for everybody, the family and everybody." So my message this morning is this: God has been in control of our lives before we were even born. It is by our faith in God, by his written scripture, and people throughout the entire world who cross our paths each and every day in our walk in life, that we are able to sustain our hope for tomorrow and for our everlasting love. That walk begins here at the table. It ends at the cross. It begins at the time we get baptized, when we have accepted Jesus as our Lord and Savior, and will end at the death in our final resting place, heaven. There's a song, and I can't think of who wrote it, but it's very popular on the news or on the radios and today. Come to the table. And I guess this last few weeks I've listened to it a little closer than I usually do. And the chorus goes, which many of you probably know, come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Set down and be set free. Come to the table. Will you please bow with me in prayer? As we come before our prepared table here, with the emblems of your broken body and shed blood, we pause to reflect back on our own lives. Our faith and hope draws us nearer to you each and every day. We come as sinners, asking forgiveness for our sins. Will you please, Lord, bless these emblems in each and every person who partakes of the cup and the loaf. We ask of this in your Son's Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
give as we can. Please bless these gifts to do good works for you. In Jesus' name, amen.
The song we're going to do for you this morning, just as an encouragement to those struggling in these times, just to turn to the Lord.
Jeremiah then returned from Topheth, where the Lord had sent him to prophesy, and he stood in the court of the Lord's temple and said to all the people, "This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Listen, I'm going to bring on this city and all the villages around it every disaster I pronounced against them. Because they were stiff-necked and they would not listen to my words. I am going to bring on this city and all the villages around it every disaster I pronounced against them, because they were stiff-necked and would not listen to my words. That's all that Jeremiah said in the temple that day. In Jeremiah 19, those are verses 14 through 15. It's a pretty short sermon. Don't be jealous. Jeremiah was a prophet called by God. Last week we talked about how he was handpicked, not just from youth, but he was picked by God before he was born. Last week when we read chapter 1, we read God telling a very young Jeremiah. God told him, I knew you before you were born. I set you apart. I appointed you to be a prophet to the nations. And then we read when God gave his words to Jeremiah by touching his mouth. I told you that you too have the call of Jeremiah, as do I. That God's word tells us that all of us who are in Jesus Christ through faith were known by God, not even just before we were born, but we were known by God before the world was created. I told you that you and I have been set apart, made into a holy and royal people with a different life than everyone else. That you have been called to give testimony to the truth of God's word, to hold out the light of Christ in a dark and depraved world. You have been appointed, just as Jeremiah had. And then finally, that you have been filled with God's word, equipped for every work of service in Christ's kingdom by the truth of the scriptures and the indwelling Holy Spirit which is given you at your baptism. Like Jeremiah, we've been given a purpose and something to do by God. Therefore, I want you to see this story of the prophet Jeremiah not just as a tale as old as dirt about a prophet way back when, but the story of the prophet of Jeremiah is your story and my story. The story of a child of God that is known, set apart, appointed, and gifted. The passage that I just read to you was not Jeremiah's first proclamation in the temple. That was not the first time that he spoke in the temple courts. But it is the first time that Jeremiah goes there with a message so brief and devastating. You see, Jeremiah was the son of the high priest, the nephew of a prophetess in the days of Josiah. He was already an important man from an important family. People knew who he was. He had authority and status. Add to that, by this time, when we encounter Jeremiah in Jeremiah 19, he had been a prophet for some time. His reputation as a prophet was well known. God had sent him all over Judea with words to proclaim to God's people. So when he went into the temple court, he would have had an audience. People would have been paying attention. Jeremiah is not there to deliver an invitation or an altar call. He's not there to tell the Israelites to repent so that the wrath of God can be taken away from them. He's done that already. This is what Jeremiah tells them. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Listen, I am going to bring on this city and all the villages around it every disaster I pronounced against them, because they were stiff-necked and would not listen to my words. I doubt they sung a closing song. Those words would sting a little. If you were going to deliver a message like that, you might consider hiring a bodyguard or 10. But Jeremiah didn't have bodyguards. Because remember that God, last week when we read chapter 1, God told Jeremiah to not be afraid, that God will protect him. God called Jeremiah at a very young age when he was still a teenager, and he told him to not be afraid of the people that he was going to deliver his message to. In fact, I want us to read that promise again from Jeremiah chapter 1. God told him, "Get yourself ready. Stand up and say to them whatever I command you. Do not be terrified by them, or I will terrify you before them. Today I have made you a fortified city, an iron pillar and a bronze wall, to stand against the whole land, against the kings of Judah, its officials, its priests, and all the people of the land. They will fight against you, but will not overcome you, for I am with you, and I will rescue you, declares the Lord." Jeremiah is promised protection by God. The same protection that God promises us. Because just as we are called, like Jeremiah is called, to give witness to God, just as we have been known before our birth, like Jeremiah is, to do God's work, so too, we have this same promise of protection from our Father in heaven. Because of this promise, Jeremiah is brave enough to march into the temple courts and pronounce doom. So let's go on to read how Jeremiah is protected by God after he said these words. We'll start reading in chapter 20, verse 1. The verse appears in your bulletin. I'm sorry, it won't. It won't appear in your bulletin until verse 7. I was wrong about that. Jeremiah 20, verse 1. I'll read it to you. "When the priest Pashur, son of Immer, the official in charge of the temple of the Lord, heard Jeremiah prophesying these things, he had Jeremiah the prophet beaten and put in the stocks at the upper gates of Benjamin at the Lord's temple." Jeremiah is beaten and put in the stocks. You know the stocks, you've seen pictures of them where you, it's like a yoke where you hang your head and your hands through and are left to be humiliated in public. It's interesting, the stocks are what we think of maybe a punishment from the medieval period. They don't appear in the Bible often. The only other time somebody's putting stocks in the Bible are Paul and Silas in prison, and so they weren't on public display there, but it seems that Jeremiah here was put on public display. The only time in the Bible somebody's put in stocks, Jeremiah is put there to be humiliated so that everybody could see Jeremiah and mock him. But God told Jeremiah when he was called, "I have made you a fortified city, an iron pillar, and a bronze wall." But despite that, here sits Jeremiah in stocks, beaten and humiliated. God promised Jeremiah that the officials and the priests in Judah would not overcome him, but now Pashur has beaten him and locked him up in an ignominious public display. I want us to read Jeremiah's prayer to God when he gets out of the stocks. We'll skip down to verse 7. Now you could read it in your bulletin. Listen to Jeremiah's reaction. He says, "You deceived me, Lord, and I was deceived. You overpowered me and prevailed. I'm ridiculed all day long. Everyone mocks me. Whenever I speak, I cry out, proclaiming violence and destruction. So the word of the Lord has brought me insult and reproach all day long." Jeremiah claims to have been tricked by God. He thinks he got the raw end of the deal here. I think he would like to remind God of the protection that he had been promised in chapter 1. Here's where Jeremiah's path once again crosses our own. You see, I think Jeremiah was living in an age very much like the one we're living in. Jeremiah appeared as the kingdom of Judah was setting. at dusk. A society with the assumptions and trappings and appearance of faithfulness to God, but one that had grown rotten at the core and had not yet realized the full consequence of their rejection of God and the rejection of God's word as truth. Jeremiah was the bearer of a message that was too uncomfortable to hear. He delivered it to a people who are convinced that they didn't need to listen to him, that he was a madman worthy of being put in stocks and humiliated. Aren't we living in Jeremiah's time? Don't we live in a world that doesn't want to hear what God has to say? A world that doesn't want to be told how God feels about money, wealth, or greed? A world that doesn't want to be told about how God feels about justice and mercy or self-sacrifice? A world that does not want to be told how God feels about sexuality, marriage? A world even that doesn't want to be told just the simple fact that we're guilty of sin, in need of forgiveness, and that our natural inclination is a bent towards evil and darkness. Not only can we observe this in our society, but we can often observe these same inclinations in our own hearts. See, Jeremiah was sent to confront those inclinations, to wake up a people who had fallen asleep to those truths, to pronounce God's judgment upon them when they refused to listen. And what happened to Jeremiah? Jeremiah languished in a world that did not listen to God. Jeremiah suffered among a people who were not willing to hear God's truth. We, like Jeremiah, have been given the gospel and the word of truth to confront evil and the untrue ignorance of the world. We've been given this mission, known by God, set apart by Him, appointed, and given His word. And now here's the hard truth. We too, like Jeremiah, will languish in a world that does not listen to God. It will happen. It is still true that we have been promised protection and strength by God, like Jeremiah had. But you see, as you read Jeremiah, you'll get a good feel for the fact that Jeremiah may have initially misunderstood what God's protection implied. There seems to be a difference between what God delivered for Jeremiah and what Jeremiah was expecting God to deliver for him. Jeremiah seems a little upset about that. Maybe he expected that he would not be oppressed or mocked, that he would be received a little more warmly, to be held in higher esteem by the people who he is speaking to. So you can imagine Jeremiah's surprise and disappointment when he goes to proclaim God's message in the temple courts and gets beaten and put in stocks instead. Jeremiah's reputation, his dignity, the son of the high priest, was brought very low that day. Something very important for us to know. God's protection is different than what Jeremiah expected it would be. It's important to know also that God's protection is better than what Jeremiah imagined it would be. God's protection to Jeremiah and God's protection for us in our lives as we serve Him is better than the momentary deliverance from suffering or shame. God's protection to us is better than the momentary sensation of popularity. God's protection is the rock-solid, unshakable promise of salvation in eternal life through the victory of Jesus Christ over sin and death. And with that assurance, we have the confidence to face anything. Unlike Jeremiah, we at least have been warned about what will happen to us in the meantime. In 1 John chapter 3, verse 13, I believe it's 3 and I hit the wrong key. My apologies. We're told, "Do not be surprised, my brothers and sisters, if the world hates you." Jesus tells us this in John 15, starting in verse 18. He says, "If the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. Or if you belong to the world, rather, if you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. That is why the world hates you. Remember what I told you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. If they obeyed my teaching, then they will obey yours also. They will treat you this way because of my name, for they do not know the one who sent me." Not only do we have Jeremiah's example for us to look back on and see the kind of suffering that we can endure while still enjoying God's protection as promised, we have our Lord Jesus Christ, who suffered under the hands of men, only to be delivered by God and win the greatest victory in the history of creation. The truth is that we will face opposition, that God's promise of protection and deliverance for you will not mean that we will never be uncomfortable. God's protection over us does not mean that we will always be popular and liked. God has commissioned us to share His truth with a dark world, and it's a world that doesn't want to hear it. We're living in a time like Jeremiah's, where it seems more and more we will become the object of scorn for proclaiming what God has told us through His Word. You need to know that when you encounter that opposition or these insults, when you are humiliated like Jeremiah was that day in the temple courts, that it is not a sign of God failing to protect you. Instead, if you're being faithful to God's service and to His Word, it is a sign of your faithfulness to God. I want you to listen to the next words from Jeremiah in this chapter of prayer. We read verses 7 and 8. Now hear verse 9. "But if I say I will not mention him or speak any more in his name, his word is in my heart like a fire. A fire welled up in my bones. I am weary of holding it in. Indeed, I cannot." After all Jeremiah had been through, after proclaiming God's message as he had been commissioned, and then being beaten by an official in charge of the temple, being locked up in the stocks and humiliated, Jeremiah cries out and claims to have been tricked by God. He complains about how hard this mission is that God has asked him to do. But then he admits, even after all this, if I say that I won't fulfill this purpose anymore, I can't help myself because God's word is in my heart like a fire. Despite Jeremiah's surprise and disappointment of being persecuted, he remained faithful to the mission that God had for him. He would continue to prophesy. He would continue to deliver God's word to the people of Judah. Sadly, he would continue to suffer for doing so. Sadder still, he would continue to bellyache a little bit about enduring that suffering. We've been given a mission from God like Jeremiah has. Each of us, in our own lives, the people we've been given access to, and the skills that we've been given for service in God's kingdom, we are to use those opportunities and those gifts to share God's salvation with the world, to hold out the light of the gospel in the darkness. When we do that, we will encounter opposition. And even though God has promised to protect us, even though God has promised to deliver us ultimately, we will still endure suffering, unpopularity, and opposition. Tragically, we will not get to bear this burden in equal measures, all of us. Some of us will suffer to a much greater degree for proclaiming God's truth than the rest of us. This is often just a matter of who you encounter in life, and maybe also how brave or courageous you are about sharing God's truth. Some of us will have to deal with the pain of proclaiming God's truth to a family member who rejects it and who may reject you for proclaiming it. Some of us may have to deal with a coworker or an employer who may reject you for doing the same. There are people around the world who have to endure governments who persecute and even execute them for proclaiming the truth of God's word. They bear the greatest burden of all. But through these things, I want to encourage you to not like Jeremiah who complained, but to celebrate and revel in the faithfulness you have shown to God's call. To gain confidence from the ultimate knowledge that our salvation is rock solid in Jesus Christ and cannot be shaken. We don't need to be beaten and put in stocks like Jeremiah to suffer for expressing our faith. I think of it can be much more minor than that. Still painful. I was thinking of a time I spent with my family recently. We're just having a discussion about church and what the Bible says. And someone in my family who I love and respect, somebody who loves Jesus and is going to heaven, started picking on me a little bit. You wouldn't believe it. Such a shame. Started picking on me. They rejected something the Bible says. They just didn't agree with it. Thought it was ridiculous. And I'll tell you what it is, even though it's a subject that requires much more care and delicacy and discussion than I'll give it today. But someone who asked me, why doesn't your church have women elders? Well, I said, you know, we're equal under God. The Bible tells us that there's neither slave nor free, Jew nor Greek, male nor female. But also says when it's giving the qualifications for an elder, it says they should be the husband of but one wife. So it's what the Bible says. That's what I got to do. And I was read the Riot Act. Have you guys experienced this before, maybe? And it hurt. This is one of the very few people on this earth to whom I will readily admit they are much smarter than I am. And they were just dressing me up and down for thinking that a woman couldn't be an elder for asserting the truthfulness of God's word and just saying that whatever opinion I hold regarding it, I will obey what it says. It's so minor. So minor. Such a light burden for me to bear. I'm not ignorant of the fact that in your family, you may have a heavier burden to bear. That you may confront people who you love and tell them that they're in need of God's forgiveness. That they're in need of being cleansed by Jesus Christ. They might tell you no. They might push you away for having told them that. Jeremiah was beaten and put in stocks. He bellyached about it a little, but given the prospect of stopping, given the prospect of no longer proclaiming God's message, he said he couldn't do it. It was like a fire in his heart welled up in his bones. So as we close this morning, I just want to offer you an encouragement that the suffering or opposition you encounter when you declare God's truth in your family or in your workplace, in your community, it's not a rejection from God. It's not a failure of God to protect you. But it is the battle between light and darkness in the world, in a war to which you have been commissioned. Please join me in prayer. Dear God, we lift up those who are close to us, who have turned away from your truth. We ask that you will soften their hearts. We ask that you will give us strength in the moments and opportunities we have to give witness to your truth. Dear God, the way that you have provided for the forgiveness of our sins and our salvation is incredible. Our heart breaks for those who don't know it and experience that salvation, who don't walk in your truth. Dear God, help us to find every opportunity to proclaim it. And help us to endure suffering with the strength that comes from knowing that you called us before birth, set us apart, you've anointed us for this purpose and filled us with your words. Praise in your name. Amen.
We stand as we close today.